Hello, namaste. My name is Jyoti Mathur and I'm from Bachpan Bachao Andolan. Today's session, we are going to talk about the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2015. And we are going to specifically talk about provisions which are in place for children who are in conflict with law. But before we go into the detailed provisions that are there for such children, let us first understand why this new act came into being. Let me tell you, this is a new act. This is not an amendment in the 2000 Act. So why this new act came into being in 2015 when we already had an act in 2000? In fact, the 2000 act was amended in 2006. It was amended in 2011 as well. So it could have been amended in 2015. Why a new act? The government of India proposed a new act. There were several reasons for this. One important reason, we'll look at all the reasons in detail, but one important reason was that the institutions and the functionaries who were implementing this act were not clear about their roles and responsibilities. For instance, a child welfare committee, which is responsible for dealing with children who are in need of care and protection, was seen in some states passing orders for adoption. Now, an adoption order can only be passed by a court. A child welfare committee is not competent to pass that order. So this was happening because this committee was not clear about their roles and responsibilities. The second reason was that there were no timelines in the act. It was seen in many places that children who were committing minor crimes, petty crimes, were staying in institutions for 3 years, which was not required. They should have been outside the institution. They should have been with their families. But this was happening because there was no timelines in the act. It was also felt after the Nirbhaya case, where we know a child who was below 18 years of age committed, was part of that group that committed the crime. It is not necessary. We will not say that the child had committed a very heinous crime, but yes, he was in conflict with law, and it was felt that for such children or for any other children who commits a heinous crime, a 3-year reformation period is not enough. Such children may require a longer reformation period. So an amendment was required in the act. The third reason was that the provisions in the 2000 Act for adoption of orphan, abandoned and surrendered children were not clearly included. They were part of an adoption regulations or guidelines prepared by CARA, but they were not part of the act. And in that guidelines also, there were no timelines. So on one hand, we all know that, you know, we have seen people and families who want to adopt children and they are looking for children to adopt. On the other hand, we know that there are children who are living in institutions. They are waiting to be adopted, but they could not be matched. So that matching was not happening. CARA did not have that much of power. So an amendment in that was also required. And the last most important point was related to crimes committed against children. So here, although the crimes against children are covered in various laws, like for example, IPC, we have special laws like POXO, we have PCMA, Child Marriage Act, we also have labor laws. But it was felt there are some more crimes which are of heinous nature, which if committed against adults, there is punishment in IPC. But when it is committed against a child, the punishment should be higher. So it was felt to include such crimes in the Juvenile Justice Act purview also. And with so many changes requiring to make the act stronger, the government of India felt that instead of amending the act with so many changes and amendments, why not make a new act keeping the experience of the 2000 act in mind and make a law which is stronger, which is effective, with clarity, and everything that needs to be covered is included in it. And that is why we have the 2015 act. Now let us understand what are the provisions in the act for children who are in conflict with law. So we will first look at the definitions, the key definitions. This session will give you some important points about these children, but for detail, it is always advisable that you go through the law, the law itself, to understand the detailed provisions. Now, the first important change in the new law is that the nomenclature has been changed from juvenile in conflict with law to that of a child who is in conflict with law. So the word juvenile is not used for a child who is in conflict with law. Why? Because it was felt in the 2000 Act that the word juvenile has some negative connotation. So to remove that, now juvenile, although it is there in the title, it is there in the institution like Juvenile Justice Justice Board. It is there in the Special Juvenile Police Unit, but when we are referring to a child, juvenile word is not used. Now the next is, who is a child in conflict with law? A child in conflict with law is who is either alleged, so before the inquiry, or is found after the inquiry by the board to have committed an offence, and that offence alleged or is found to be committed by the child is done when he has not completed the age of 18 years on the date of the commission of the offence. So his age is calculated, his or her age is calculated from the date the child is alleged to have committed offence, and not when the child is brought before the board or apprehended or for whatever the information is disclosed to the police. And the third very important definition which was missing in the earlier act is the offences that could be committed by the child. So there are different offences. They are classified into three types. So first is petty. Petty are those offences where the punishment under IPC for that crime or any other law that is there in the country is maximum 3 years. So that is a petty offence. So an example of petty offence is theft. The second is serious offence. Serious are those offences where punishment under IPC or any other law that is there in the country is between 3 to 7 years. And lastly are heinous offences. Heinous offences are those where punishment again in IPC or any other law is minimum 7 years, but it can go to any years. Now, let us first understand that these offences and these punishments are there for the, these are classified to understand the way the child is to be treated when the child is caught or apprehended for committing such a crime. So the punishment under these three, petty, serious and heinous, are not necessarily to be given to the child, but it can be as per the decision, as whatever the board decides, so those punishments are given. Now let us understand, so after definitions, what are the institutions, what is the main institution for dealing with these children? So we can see the main institution is the Juvenile Justice Board. Now this Juvenile Justice Board is there in every district. It was there in earlier act also. The new thing in this act is that now the act says it is, yes, headed by a principal magistrate and two members who are actually social workers. But the new thing is that the earlier act said that this principal magistrate could be a CJM, a chief judicial magistrate, or a chief metropolitan magistrate. And that was actually leading to pendency in the act, because a CJM or CMM has so many other things to do in a district, and if he or she is also looking after a juvenile justice board, it will lead to pendency. Now to reduce pendency, the act says that this principal magistrate who is heading the board cannot be a CJM or a CMM. The next is that the principal magistrate should have at least 3 years of experience of working with children. And the third is the members who are the social workers, they should not be less than 35 years of age, and they should have at least 7 years of experience, or they could be, if they don't have 7 years of experience, they could be a practicing professional with a degree in child psychology, child behavior and child related subjects. So this is what is there for Juvenile Justice Board. Now let us understand new and additional provision in this act for the Juvenile Justice Board. To make the Juvenile Justice Board work efficiently, effectively, and for the welfare and protection of children, the Act says that the members of the board and the principal magistrate also must be provided training within 60 days from the date of their appointment. Now, this will ensure that the day they start working on the Juvenile Justice Board, they are trained, they are sensitized, they are aware of the provisions, and take corrective measures as per the provisions of the Act. The new act also says that the board should sit on all working days for a minimum of 6 hours per day. Now this provision, there could be districts, say somewhere in the northeast or any other part of the country where there are not many cases, where the board need not sit for all working days, or maybe not necessary for 6 hours every day. Then in that case, the state government has the power to give a notification that the board is not not required to sit for so many days. It could be otherwise also, where the board may need to sit for more than six hours per day. That is also decided by the state government depending upon the cases being received by the board in that particular district. Now, another important thing is that there could be situations, we all know that in this 6 hours where the board is sitting, it is not necessary that all the cases that happen in that district, in that area, come before the board within those 6 hours only. There could be cases when, the police comes across such cases at odd hours during night or after those 6 hours that have been prescribed in the act. In such a case, the principal magistrate is required to draw a roster of members who will be present 24/7 for the child to be produced before them. Now, the principal magistrate once prepares the roster, the name of the member available on a particular day is given to the police, is given to the district child protection unit, is given to a child care institution, so that they know on one or two days the such and such member would be present, and this is his phone number, his landline number, his mobile number, his address, so that the police can, produce the child before that member on that particular day. Now, let us see what are the functions of the board. The functions of the board, if we can think that since this board is responsible for taking care of children who are in conflict with law, so yes, it has to do everything in the well-being of the child, for the welfare of the child, and for the care and protection of the child. So it has to ensure that the views of the child are taken at every stage. So child participation, a very important principle of this act, is to be followed by the Juvenile Justice Board also. The board also has to ensure that the child rights are protected throughout the process of inquiry, of aftercare, of rehabilitation. Now, what are those child rights? Child rights are like, for instance, child should not be discriminated. Child's views should be heard. Child's welfare of, providing a shelter, of good food, of protection is given, all those things are ensured and provided to the child. Child right is also the child, if need not be sent to an institution, child should be sent to the parents of the guardians of the child. He or she should be allowed to stay with them. So these are the different child rights that the board has to ensure that they are ensured. The second is that, the next point is that the legal aid. Now, legal aid is a right of the child, and the board has to ensure that the child is represented by a lawyer. And this lawyer, the board can ask from a district legal service authority who is required to provide legal services to the child. The board must ensure that no child comes before the board without a legal representation. Next is wherever. So they could be a situation, if we are sitting in Punjab, a child who has committed a crime, say is from West Bengal, or is say from down south, from Karnataka or Tamil Nadu. Now that child might require a translator or an interpreter. So the board has to provide the translator to the child. And from where does the board get these persons? These persons are provided by a district child protection unit, which is a fundamental unit at the district level for the implementation of this act. There could be also a situation when a child is is not able to speak properly, is a special needs child, then a special educator can also be provided by the board, again to be procured with the help of district child protection unit. Now, the last point that is written on this slide is very important. This is important because we believe, the Act believes, that every child who comes in contact with the system is actually in need of care and protection. And when this need, protection and care is not given to the child at the right time by the right people, then this child comes in contact with the law, becomes in conflict with law. So the child is basically in need of care and protection. So at any point of the inquiry, at any stage, if the board feels that this child is also in need of care and protection, the matter can be transferred to a child welfare committee. And till the case is decided, the CWC, the child welfare committee, and the juvenile justice board can take action together. Now, if we move forward to understand more the functions which are related not directly to the child, but other things that the board needs to do other than looking after the proceedings of the board is that it is also required to conduct at least one inspection visit every month of the child care institutions which are meant for these children. So it is not a children's home, for instance, which is meant for children in need of care and protection. So the board is required to inspect those institutions which are meant for children in conflict with law. Let me just quickly explain which are these institutions for these children. So first of all, we know there is an observation home where a child is sent during the pendency of inquiry. The second is a special home. Special home is a place where a child is sent after the inquiry has been completed and the board feels that the child needs rehabilitation, needs to stay in an institution. So a child is sent to a special home. And the third category, which is new in this act, it is called place of safety. What is this place of safety? Place of safety is a place where children who are between the 16 to 18 years of age who are found to be in conflict with law of a heinous crime are kept. Okay, and then there are also persons who are above 18 years of age who could have committed a crime when they were a child. They are also kept in a place of safety. So these are the three institutions that are meant for children in conflict with law, and these are the institutions which a juvenile justice board is required to inspect every month. Then in certain cases, which we will see when we move ahead with the session, is in certain cases there could be FIR needs to be registered, and it could be a situation when a crime has been committed by the child, or for instance a crime is committed against the child. Then the Juvenile Justice Board has the power to order the police to register an FIR. The board is also required to conduct regular inspection of jails. Why jails? Because there is a possibility that children who are below 18 years of age are lodged in jails. They are not produced before the board. They are produced before some other magistrate, and where by mistake, or maybe by knowingly, they are sent. They are sent to the jail meant for adults. So those children are to be brought back to the juvenile justice system. So the board is required to inspect jails, and if they find children lodged there, they should bring them back to the juvenile justice system. And the next provision that you can see on the slide here is pass orders for readmission of a child in a school. So there could be a situation where, for instance, a child who is in conflict with law is required to stay in institution for some time, and when goes back to his family and wants to go back to the school might refuse to take the child, thinking that this child had committed a crime. So the board can pass an order asking the school authorities for readmission of the child in the school. While doing its functions, the board can deploy services of student volunteers or NGOs for paralegal tasks. So that option is there for the board to. Now let us see how the pendency of the board is reviewed under the new act. So you can see on the slide it is at three levels, and every level it is reviewed every quarter. So the first is the CJM or the Chief Metropolitan Magistrate. They review the pendency of the board every quarter. The second is a high level committee. This high level committee is formed at the state level, which is headed by the State Legal Service Authority's chairperson. It also has members from the WCD or the Social Justice Department, whichever department is implementing this act in the state, is a second member. And the third is the Home Department. Now the chairperson of this committee can also appoint an NGO or any other individual to be part of this committee. This committee again monitors the pendency of the cases before the board every quarter. And the third is the district judge. Now the district judge is not only required to monitor the pendency but also required to do an inspection of the board when it is functioning to see if it is following all the child-friendly procedures that are provided in the law, they are being followed by the board or not. An important point here is that this is all these provisions, as you can see, are monitored every quarter. So what is a board required to do to ensure that this monitoring and this review is done efficiently? The board is required to maintain a case monitoring sheet. Now this case monitoring sheet actually shows whenever a case is brought before the board. In the case monitoring sheet, on the first day, first production of the child, the board has to decide, has to know and list when the case is expected to be completed. And then thereafter, write down the stages, fill in the stages and write down the dates to, and also aware that it has to finish the case before the date it has written on the first production itself. So this is about the pendency of the board. Now we will go through the procedures that are there in the Act for different offenses that have been committed by the child, and that we will understand through flowchart. So with this, we come to the conclusion of today's session. In today's session, we learned about the Juvenile Justice Act, Care and Protection Act, which why it came into being in 2015. What are the provisions for children who are in conflict with law? What are the institutions meant to deal with these children? What are the procedures that are to be followed? And what are the ways in which the pendency and other things are being taken care of in this Act? Thank you very much.